Harper Audio presents Chasing Space, an astronaut's story of grit, grace, and second chances by Leland Melvin. Read by Ron Butler. One. I really can't hear. On my first day of spacewalk training in NASA's Neutral Buoyancy Laboratory at the Johnson Space Center, the future loomed in front of me as bright as the heavens I had hoped to reach. I wanted to master the fundamentals, and like all astronauts, I knew that spacewalk proficiency was the quickest path to that coveted first flight assignment. The sooner I could fly, the more time I would have to spend off-planet, getting my orbital shift on. There are almost 7.5 billion people living on Earth. Only 555 of them have ever flown in space. Of that number, 362 were American astronauts. It's a very, very exclusive club. And as I prepared for the day's trials, I was determined to join it. I began my descent to the bottom of the cavernous pool that houses a submerged space shuttle and International Space Station to practice installing and attaching hardware with the goal of one day doing similar work on the real $150 billion space station orbiting high above the planet. I had completed many scuba runs in the pool before, but training for extravehicular activity, EVA, in the suit, is more like walking in the weightless environment of space. It isn't easy. The suit alone made me look like a cross between the Pillsbury Doughboy and the Michelin Man. At a depth of 10 feet, I noticed the little block of styrofoam, called the Valsalva device, was missing. The device is usually attached at nose level, inside the helmet, to help a diver clear his or her ears by simply pressing the nose against it. Just a week earlier, I made sure to tell the technician that I needed it. Through the helmet headset, I told test director Greg Sims that the device was missing. I enjoyed working with Greg. We met a few months earlier in Huntsville, Texas, when he administered the qualification dives for my scuba certification. I should have stopped the dive to get a new device, but I wanted to go on with my training. So I convinced myself, and Greg, that I could continue without any problems. Okay, he said. Just don't hurt yourself. It didn't take long before my ears felt full, like the pressure a passenger feels when a plane shifts in flight, only much worse. Desperate to clear my ears, I thrust my head forward to position my nose on the helmet neck ring, but it was too far out of reach. My doctors would later tell me that either my background as a professional athlete or my high tolerance for pain prevented me from realizing the true severity of my situation. Maybe. But on April 3, 2001, I simply told myself that my ears would clear. I knew something was wrong at 20 feet. I can't hear you, I told Greg. Can you turn the volume up? I strained to hear a response, but all I got was static. I figured something was wrong with either the headset or the cable running from my suit to the pool deck, as one kink in the cable could shut down the sound. Turn up the volume, I shouted into the microphone, wondering why the men on the other end of the line were ignoring me. Greg and his team began to raise me slowly up and down in the pool, thinking it might clear my ears in much the same way increasing altitude can do on an airplane. I still couldn't hear Greg. Seconds later, I heard an irritating sound from the headset, followed by faint crackles and an obscured voice. Somebody was trying to tell me something, but I couldn't make out the words. At that point, the training ended. As I floated toward the surface, I saw Danny Olivas, a fellow trainee, at the bottom of the pool ready to demonstrate his EVA skills. I know he was thinking, "What the hell is going on with Leland?" and probably wondering if my problem would delay his training. Dr. Richard McCluskey, a NASA flight surgeon who was assisting with the exercise, was waiting for me. The technician who helped me out of my helmet was the same guy in charge of my suit fit check, the test run of all the equipment I would use the day of my underwater training. He had asked me if I needed a Valsalva device, and multiple scuba dives in the Red Sea had taught me that I could only clear my ears by blocking my nostrils, so I had said yes. The look on the doctor's face told me something had gone wrong. In fact, I saw concern on everyone's faces. They were all mouthing words without sound, and I wondered why they didn't just speak up. When Dr. McCluskey touched my right ear, I noticed the blood on his finger and began to feel it running down the side of my face. He quickly examined my ears and observed retraction of my tympanic membrane, the eardrum. Suspecting the problem occurred from the underwater change in pressure, he administered a nasal spray and politzerization, a medical procedure that involves inflating the middle ear by blowing air up the nose. Neither effort worked. I still couldn't hear. Dr. McCluskey then escorted me to the hyperbaric altitude chamber, which simulates the experience of an airplane ascending in flight. At 10,000 feet, I didn't feel any different. But when the doctor tried to inflate my middle ear a second time, my ears began to clear. I could hear a little better. According to the medical records, I could hear speech from about 5 feet away. However, when the chamber brought me back to sea level, my ears became blocked again, and I was unable to hear much of anything. All I could do was sit inside the steel tube, peering through the windows at the faces of the doctors and technicians, and wonder if they felt any responsibility for damaging a member of the NASA family. After my stint in the altitude chamber, the room seemed to spin, and the walls, fixtures, and faces tumbled together in a confusing whirl. I threw up when I got to the shower. Thank goodness I made it that far. My next stop was the flight medicine clinic, which wasn't far from the Space Center. The doctors there examined my ears and performed balance tests that I passed easily. Not bad for someone bleeding from his ear. Still, I couldn't hear. The doctors then had me transported to Houston Methodist Hospital, where I was examined by Dr. Bobby Alford, a renowned ear, nose, and throat specialist. He admitted me to the hospital after a battery of hearing and balance tests revealed severe bilateral hearing loss. My treatment would consist of antibiotics, antivirals, and carbon dioxide to increase blood flow to the brain. Unfortunately, my doctors could not determine the cause of my deafness. "Suspect cochlear process as source of hearing loss," one of my doctor's medical reports stated. "Ruptured round window possible, but unlikely. Possibilities include ruptured or damaged Reissner's membrane, patient cochlear aqueduct, vascular lesions, infections, or undetermined." Dr. Alford thought exploratory surgery might provide clues. Just hours before, I had been on top of the world, brimming with confidence. I was pursuing my future in space. Now, I lay in a recovery room, confused, disoriented, and uncertain. I watched as Dr. Alford scribbled notes on his yellow legal pad. The eardrums were intact, and an MRI revealed no evidence of a stroke. Yet, they couldn't find the exact cause of my problem in my right ear. As much as I wanted to discover the cause of my hearing loss, I was more concerned with the space agency's response to my situation. If something bad happens to an astronaut in training, and NASA can't explain it, the astronaut won't fly. My medical status changed, and as soon as it did, the nurses in charge of documents immediately altered my records to read DNIF, short for Duty Not Involving Flying. This medical disqualification barred me from future training in NASA's high-performance jets, and I could forget those thoughts of living and working off-planet. One mistake had brought 3 years of training to a sudden, dispiriting halt. I wondered if I would ever get my time in space, or be consigned to an earthbound existence, left to look up forlornly at the stars. The Right Stuff. Astronaut culture is a world Tom Wolfe famously described as divided into those who have the right stuff and those who don't. Some folks are just born with it, and to prove they have it, they never admit defeat or show weakness. They certainly never end up in the hospital with sudden and profound deafness because a tiny block of styrofoam was missing from their helmet. For decades, the right stuff type of astronaut typically was a military pilot, somehow supernaturally graced with the ability to go up in a hurtling piece of machinery and put his hide on the line, and then have the moxie, the reflexes, the experience, the coolness, to pull it all back in at the last yawning moment. That's how Wolfe described it. A military pilot faced a 23% chance of dying in an aircraft accident, and a greater than 50-50 chance of someday having to make a perilous ejection out of the jet and come down in a parachute. Yet, they still fly. I never saw myself as one of those guys. They were the decorated officers who fought in Desert Storm and Iraqi Freedom. They talked about angle of attack and dogfighting, spoke of days when their butts were on the line trying to save troops or keep the bad guys from hurting the United States. They had call signs like Dex, Hawk, Ray J, and Zambo. They sacrificed so much to protect this country. I came to the space program as a civilian, not a military test pilot. Until 3 years ago, I had been a research scientist working to develop optical fiber sensors at NASA Langley in Hampton, Virginia. Before that, I was completing my master's degree with hopes of starting a lucrative career in the chemical industry. I was recruited to join NASA at a time when the space program was trying to improve the diversity of its workforce. I never aspired to a life off the ground, much less to become an astronaut. I knew that whatever path of life I was on, I wanted to do my best. But this stuff Tom Wolfe described? How could I have the right stuff? The nation's space program has made progress from its days when the staff and leadership of the space agency were largely white and male. We certainly have come a long way since May 25, 1961, when President John F. Kennedy stood before Congress and announced that the United States should commit to landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to Earth within the decade. However, during that time, America's race relations were in turmoil. Dozens of freedom riders had put their lives on the line when they boarded interstate buses to travel across the American South in an inspired mission to end racial segregation. On Kennedy's orders, a reluctant NASA selected Ed Dwight as the first African-American to join the space program. "Kennedy picked me out of the turnip patch and plopped me in the middle of this," Dwight told People magazine years later. "The Air Force and NASA felt someone was trying to cram a nigger down their throats." Ed belonged in NASA. Born in the Kansas City, Kansas area, he was an avid reader and enjoyed the arts. In 1953, he joined the U.S. Air Force, and within 3 years, he became a test pilot. He rose to the rank of captain and earned a bachelor's degree in aeronautical engineering from Arizona State University. In 1961, the Kennedy administration selected Ed to be the first African-American astronaut trainee. The move brought favorable media coverage, particularly among the black press. Enduring criticisms from fellow astronaut trainees and demeaning incidents at NASA, like his assignment as a liaison to a test pilot facility in Germany that didn't exist, took their toll. Dwight told Ebony magazine that Kennedy's death in 1963 prompted him to leave the space program, but that seemed like only part of the reason. Another 20 years would pass before the first African-American would fly in space. I was well aware just how quickly an astronaut could be disqualified from flying. The annual physical with the NASA flight surgeon is something to be feared. Every astronaut knows you can walk into the doctor's office a test pilot and walk out a desk jockey. Physicals by flight surgeons are so dreaded that pilots often go to great lengths to have medical procedures done off base, sometimes even in secret. Alan Shepard knew this as well as anyone. In the late 1950s, Shepard had been one of the original seven astronauts recruited by NASA for Project Mercury. These hand-picked former military test pilots, fighter jocks who would become known.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.